products is strongly regulated, and minors are not permitted to enter facilities where these products are on display. This is the the zone where retail is a permitted principal use, and the 300 meter school buffer is turned on.
Any questions? Any comments?
I think this is excellent, and I feel like we're just a little bit behind the boat on this one, but so is every other municipality, and I'd love to see us take an absolutely firm stance on the within through the same. I think it should be absolutely the same as the marijuana bylaw.
Did anyone disagree with that?
No.
Okay, move on.
Okay, so the fourth set of amendments addresses electric vehicle charging stations. Rising fuel costs combined with rapidly changing technology are making electric vehicles more popular with British Columbians. BC Hydro has forecasted that there will be 300,000 electric vehicles on BC's roads by 2031. This forecasted increase in electric vehicles will fuel demand for residential electric vehicle charging stations. And a report by the Condominium Homeowners Association of BC suggests that planning for the installation and accommodation of these facilities at construction is much more economical than installing them in older buildings. Two other municipalities surveyed have been anticipating the increase in demand for electric vehicle charging and require electric vehicle charging facilities in new multifamily developments. So staff are proposing to amend the zoning bylaw to require residential access to shared level two electric vehicle charging receptacles in 20% of all parking stalls in new multifamily developments. And then related to that is the parking cash in lieu. Council has directed staff to increase the cash in lieu amount for required off-street parking spaces. Currently, section 41.2C of the zoning bylaw allows the required number of off-street parking spaces to be reduced up to four, by up to four at $6,000 per space for non-residential uses in commercial zones located in the downtown area. So staff are in the process of drafting a payment in lieu of off-street parking space bylaw. And so therefore the section 41.2 of the zoning bylaw needs to be amended to reference this new bylaw. And it would just take out the cash in lieu amount out of the existing zoning bylaw.
Any questions on the electric vehicle charging stations?
Thank you. I didn't see anything down here for commercial development. I mean, commercial development should have electric charging stations. Mm-hmm. And I think the stores in there would probably like to have them. We might not need to have billboards if we have electric charging stations there. I think 20% is okay. I mean, I'm really glad to see that, but it's only 20%. And it doesn't say anything about single-family homes, which I'm sure, I guess that's just up to the homeowner, but I think why not have a plug-in there? And now on the plug-ins, it says times charge 1 hour, and that's a level one. And a level one is just a 120 plug-in with a 20 amp breaker or 15 amp breaker.
Okay.
So, well, and a level two is 4 to 6 hours, which is a 240 breaker. I don't understand how come you put more power into it and it takes longer to charge.
Okay, that's not a question for the omnibus bylaw.
Okay.
We can answer that question outside of this, but we're talking right now. The suggestion is that there's 20% level two in residential for parking stalls. I think it's an interesting suggestion about commercial. Maybe staff take that away and think about if per commercial stalls, whether there's a requirement.
On that commercial one, to talk about a presentation we had earlier about charging stations with advertising on them in commercial ones, as soon as I saw that, I thought, if I had a big store and 12 parking stalls out front, it might be good for me to put in one anyway. And I thought maybe we should have incentives for businesses to put in charging stations. Maybe that's off topic.
It is a little off topic.
I think 20% could be a little higher.
Was 20% consistent with other communities? And not to say our goal is to be consistent with other communities, just not 20%.
It was slightly lower than other communities, or slightly higher, I'm sorry. The town of View Royal has, they two per 50 parking spaces. And then the regional district couch in Valley, a couch in Lake, sorry, has the same as that. They're about the same.
So that's token.
Yeah, so it's, yeah, it's quite a bit
so
higher.
So this is quite different.
Yeah.
We got a letter a little while ago, I think it was from Metro Vin for a proposal that we can't even stand for the resolution about requiring this at the provincial level. And I'm wondering, and I can't access my email, but I can't remember if their proposal was higher than this or not, but it might be interesting just to see what's going to UBCM in a few weeks. I mean, I'd like to exceed it if it's low, but just be interesting. So I think it came from Metro Vin.
Great.
So do we talk about maybe upping the 20%?
Well, I think they're going to do a bit more homework. They're going to look at this. I think 20 to 25% is a pretty bold goal. I would be willing to go to 25, but that seems to exceed everyone else's expectations to date, which is a good thing. And it's as our previous delegation intimated, per stall, if new build, it's actually not very expensive at all. So, and
thanks. I would also be willing to go up to 25 because of new build. And if you're installing the electricity in a parking garage anyways, why not put it in the stalls? I would also like to see it in single residential, in single family residential units, the new builds as well. There's no reason why if you are building a parking garage that you can't have a charging unit
We're doing some work on the green building stuff, so I think that should come back with that single-family home stuff.
Yeah. It gets a little trickier regulating it in single-family homes versus shared parking, because we're not really getting into the building code and what we can and cannot require. It's much easier for a single-family home or even a townhouse or a duplex to convert, because you're in charge of your unit, so you can just plug in or put in the new power requirements in yourself, versus where it's a strata, it's much more complicated and more expensive.
And the other piece with why I don't mind pushing it up to 25 is there's tons of funding out there to help new builds put this in already, so a lot of those costs can be offset through government programs.
Also, I'm interested in the visitor parking stalls in the resident in townhouse units as well. Visitor parking stalls can be used by the public as well, and maybe making those visitor parking stalls accessible in new builds to outside visitors as well, or flow through traffic where it becomes part of the public, you know, like that we're sharing our visitor parking stalls, may be easier to, you know, there may be bylaws in the future where you can actually, you know, if you're driving through, you can pull into a visitor parking stall and charge for an hour if the stall's not being used. So having visitor parking stalls actually include electric charging stations in new builds would be somewhere.
I just think that's where a lot of the share would go. I mean, it would be visitors. It would just be, we're just saying 25%. I suspect a lot of them would be visitors, some would be dedicated to, but they're sharing. But they're sharing. But the piece about requiring for commercial parking stalls of these, I think that's where but I think council's generally on board with that. Cash in lieu of parking stalls, anyone disagree with what's being proposed in front of it? Let's see, any.
Okay.
Is that it?
Yeah.
I just wonder if there's people in the audience that wants to comment on the proposed omnibus changes to the zoning code. Okay, thanks. Do you need a motion that the committee receive the update from the community planning and infrastructure dated today on the proposed 2018 zoning bylaw omnibus as provided by staff and collected through this committee's discussion? That's good enough. Okay, I'll move that. Is there a second? Second by Ted. All those in favor? Opposed? Motion carries. Next up, Cleveland Commercial Height PacWest Case Study. Actually, I'm going to hold off there. We're going to do
have a spreadsheet which is a bit longer than your usual spreadsheet because it includes the site alteration permits. So normally you wouldn't see those in here, but they have been included in this edition, just a mix up. The one application I did want to touch on with council, and then we can go into council has any questions about other applications.
Mm-hmm.
We did receive an application for District Block 509 and 510 to amend the official community plan to remove the population threshold. And I just wanted to check in with council on the approach that we would take. My recommendation is that we would hold off on bringing this application to council until the OCP has been updated, rather than bringing it at the same time. It takes 6 months to a year for a complex application to be processed anyways, so this wouldn't be out of line with our regular process.
All right, so we're in the middle of this process. We had a conversation yesterday about this whole thing, so we're nearing, the next 3 months. Clear and definitive decision on that, so it doesn't make any sense to
yes.
Anyone disagree with that?
Don't disagree, but I mean, the OCP changed in the sense that it took away that threshold. Wouldn't make this application redundant?
That application would have to change as well then. If the applicants were still interested in proceeding with the amendment, they'd have to I indicate which provision of the new OCP they want to amend. Presuming that it's going to, that provision will change.
Yeah. But absolutely, I wouldn't kill that before.
Thanks.
Thank you. The other thing I wanted to highlight was there is a development that is at the building permit stage right now, which is happening on 3rd Avenue. It has no development permit. And there's about 4 or 5 properties in that area, in that corner of Victoria and 3rd Avenue, where it's there's no development permit area. None of our development permit areas apply. So there's this one project that has had no review. Luckily, it's not a bad looking project. But there may be at least one more before we update our OCP and include all of those areas that will come under the line, so it would go straight to building permit stage. And I just wanted to check in with council whether council wanted us to take on another amendment prior to the OCP being updated of the OCP to fix that error and hopefully catch that one more potential project.
And it's where the old Mountain FM building is.
That's right.
That's zone commercial.
Zone C4.
C4, that's a bit of an oversight that is included in the DP zone.
Yes, so it will be a little more work, but I think we could probably include it with the omnibus amendments. It would just be amending, in addition to the zoning bylaw, would also be amending the OCP to tweak the development permit area locations.
What's happening with the employment? Are we having the employment land strategy come back because we're losing all the projects that have not had commercial space on the second floor and including that project in all C4 zonings?
It's totally off topic, but
it's
not really.
We're talking about particular development.
That particular development does not have any second floor commercial space.
No.
And we have not changed any parking, anything to adjust for second floor commercial space. And every project that has now come forward in our downtown has no second floor commercial space.
Linda?
Thank you, Mayor Heisman. Kate Mulligan, our economic development officer, is working closely with planning on bringing that back, the economic development strategy back to council. For an update and
is there a timing?
Recommendations for what coming forward. I don't have the agenda planner in front of me, but it is a
I believe it's in October.
Yes.
I can't believe how much we've lost.
Okay, this next, the next agenda item allows for some conversation about the next
on that project.
That was all I had on my end, and so you can answer any questions.
And I don't know which one it is on here, but I know that there's somebody that applied for a site variance permit where
Or a development variance permit?
Just a site alteration bylaw.
Right, okay, site alteration.
And, I mean, I've had a few phone calls from the guy, anyway. I just wondered why the place was completely flattened to make a campsite, and he's already brought in quite a bit of fill. Why he wouldn't be allowed to just continue to bring in fill? I mean, I would have thought the site alteration was already done when it was completely cleared. I mean, completely cleared. There wasn't a tree left standing. Anyway, I'm just bringing that up because I've had a few phone calls from this guy.
Maybe go through very briefly what site alteration is, because it's not just clearing a plant.
That's right. So every time you bring in a certain amount, minimum of fill, you have to apply for a new site alteration permit. Show how much fill you're going to be bringing in, and once you get a permit, you can only bring in that fill. So you know, you bring in fill, then you want to bring more fill, you'll have to apply for another permit.
Well, right now there's preloads around, and there's opportunity where people are excavating, and for someone doing business, it's really nice to be able to scoop that stuff. You have to take a site alteration permit out every time you want to bring in. Well, maybe that's why he's so irate. I don't know. And that's not good for us.
We are going
I don't
want
to get into a site alteration permit in the development.
Yeah. Sure. I just thought I'd bring it up so staff.
Peter.
Well, to this point, you're only allowed a maximum amount of fill on site per year, right? So you can't exceed.
I'd have to refer to the bylaw.
Yeah, that is the case.
Any specific questions about
I do have a specific
list?
One.
Yeah, please.
My pet peeve was always the gateway.
Yes. I believe there is movement on that file.
Yes.
I think we've recently gotten a response from the property owners and the agents, and I think there's agreement on how to move forward with the road closure on that property. So I expect that file will be coming back to council soon.
Thanks. And to follow up one other, looking here at the 40480 pamphlet at the Garibaldi Town Center, just as file on hold pending an update, is that file still on hold?
I can speak to that. That's my file. Yeah. We haven't heard back from the applicants about how they want to move forward on that.
Okay.
I wonder if you could speak to the Teardrop property. I mean, we've gotten a lot of letters, concerns, obviously, close to the school. About what could go there or what is proposed for there? Where is that in terms of the process?
It's gone to the ADP and has passed the ADP. So the ADP made a number of comments on alterations, and so we're now working through that, through those comments with the applicants. It's not going back to ADP. It will be coming back to council probably in October. There are no variances on this proposal, so it's looking like this development permit will be able to meet all the DPRA guidelines and the zoning provisions. We have reached out to the parent groups at the school and have a number of meetings with them. They're still concerned with just the level of development there, but it is something that's permitted in the zoning bylaw, and it's a gateway site. So the density there, you know, when the district rezoned it a few years ago, it was seen as a fitting site for a higher density building.
Okay, so we'll see that soon. Yes. Okay. Any other questions about this, Ted?
I'm going to go back a little bit to the, and this is the Beasley Suite Kitchen, wanting their sun deck out front.
Yes.
I mean, these poor guys there, they moved their restaurant, applied to put an outdoor patio there 2 years ago, and I guess there's got to be some communication problem going
just
there.
Just moved this summer, how long ago? 6-8 months ago?
Maybe a year, at least a year. Anyway, and I know it's partially the owner's not understanding the requirements, but their whole summer was gone, and they didn't get their
So what's holding that up?
We have had certain requirements, like everybody else that goes through the DP process, to submit drawings. And we have not received this, as far as I'm aware, we have not received them to date. And I believe it's that file has basically gone silent. There's no movement on it at this moment.
Okay, anybody else?
The last one for me is the highways yard piece. You're talking about the unhooking the parcels. Is there an active interest in that property?
Which property is that?
The highways yard, that's the one when you come off the government and go onto the highway.
Which number is that?
It's second to last item on the. I'm assuming that's what it is anyway.
Is that a?
So it's a subdivision application, it's still active. And they have received preliminarily layout approval. And so they have to go and meet all the conditions before they can register the subdivision. But it's not something that would be coming to council.
Okay.
It's not the people of law.
What's that, M O T I?
It's M O T I. It's, I'm not sure if there's any plan to it. I think the applicants have been fairly slow in responding to us. So we go back in once in a while and check in, are you still working on this?
You'll send the last one to us.
Yeah, that's what I said.
Okay, thank you very much. I don't know if you guys are doing any work over there in planning, but.
We are.
Yeah.
Okay, let's move on to Kingsland Commercial Heights Pack West. We have scheduled this to 12:30. There is lunch for council because we don't have much to break between our afternoon meeting, so. Yes?
Mayor Heitzman, there's not lunch for staff, so we should have come.
Okay, well, if this is scheduled for 12:30, this means. Okay.
Okay, here's the Pack West site booklets pass around. Good morning, everyone. My name is Asia Phil, planner with the Community Planning and Infrastructure Department. Today, I'm presenting the second case study around Cleveland Avenue building heights. This case study looks at the former Pack West site, which is a subject of an active rezoning application. This is the continuation of the discussion that occurred back in May of this year when we looked at the Dayhue site located at the northeast corner of Cleveland and Winnipeg, and this is what's shown in the image here. So we have two goals for today's workshop. Firstly, we'd like to have a discussion specifically focused on the Pack West case study to get feedback on the massing, height, and design options for this project. Secondly, we would like to have a discussion on the policy and zoning approaches to regulating height for the Cleveland commercial area prior to developing any initial height regulations and proceeding with community and stakeholder consultation. So I'm going to get started by providing a brief summary of the height discussions from the May Committee of the Whole meeting, as well as the May ADP meeting. So at the May Committee of the Whole meeting, we discussed the first case study, and that's the 38108 Cleveland Avenue site. Council commented on the need to identify and protect our downtown public spaces, achieve architectural interest in a variety of building heights, as well as a consideration for stepping back upper stories from the street ends. Other key comments from council included encouraging employment space, preserving the commercial high street aspects of Cleveland, and considering transfer of density or development rights. ADP also reviewed this first case study. Their key comments were that 4 to 6 stories is acceptable and it's not too high, that we should identify and protect public spaces, that the fine grain of Cleveland Avenue is what gives the street its character, and that we should be aiming to achieve architectural interest and variety as a priority. ADP had mixed opinions on whether views and shading should be regulated, and they also discussed stepping back upper stories. So moving on to our second case study for the rezoning application on the Pack West site, I'm going to run through the package of design options that you have in front of you. As I do this, please feel free to interrupt with questions or comments as we go along. I'd like to keep the discussion focused specifically on Pack West for right now and to get you guys' initial feedback on the massing, height, and design options. And this application is for rezoning from the current CD37 zone to a C4 downtown commercial zone or something similar to a C4. So I'll start with the building sections of the four options which are shown here, and these I think are located at the very back of the package. Option one's concept is focused on stepping back the upper stories. Option two's concept is a podium with a tower typology. Option three's concept has the overall building massing shifted to one end of the site, and this could be either to the north or the south end of the site. And option four's concept is for three buildings, again with a stepping back of the upper stories. Staff's initial thoughts here are that the massing could be broken up even more, such as by increasing the number of buildings or amount of open space, and that the height could be mitigated by a more significant stepping back of the upper floors. We also want to see a fine-grained articulation applied to breaking up the massing that would reflect the existing Cleveland character with the 25 to 50 foot building widths. The site plans for the four options are shown here. We'd like to see the plaza spaces emphasized and the surrounding building designed to really enhance and activate those public spaces. We would also like to see options around screening the parkade on the east or the loggers lane side of the site. Things like small office or commercial units or other creative screening ideas, because we don't want to ignore the loggers lane side and have a long blank facade running along at street level. So here's the first of the five view perspectives. This is looking southeast, and it really provides an overview of the four design options. I'm going to quickly run through all of this. This is the second view perspective. This looks south along Cleveland Avenue from the perspective of someone standing on Cleveland just north of Main Street, so beside OCM Pavilion. We asked the applicant to develop options that would preserve the views of the Chief from the south end of Junction Park and the intersection of Cleveland and Main. And we also asked that they preserve views of the Chief from the House on Brew Pub's pub and patio side. The third view again looks south, this time standing from the perspective of someone who's standing on the north and east of OCM Pavilion in Junction Park. The fourth view looks eastward from the perspective of someone standing on the House on Brew Pub's patio. The fifth view looks eastward again, this time from the perspective of someone standing at Main and Cleveland. So the applicants also provided shadow studies. This is based on the spring and fall equinox. We'd like to avoid shading Junction Park as a priority, as well as the community gardens that are located on the northwest corner of Cleveland and Main. We also want to avoid shading the House on Brew Pub's patio. So we brought PAC West to ADP in August, and so I wanted to summarize some of ADP's key comments. Given the large site and location, and so it's an entire block with four frontages, ADP's first comment was to aim to create a landmark development with a really unique design. A common design theme could apply across the site, but avoid exact replication of buildings. Commercial or office at grade fronting all streets activates the pedestrian realm. Avoid having the parkade directly fronting the street. Consider lining through block connections with commercial uses to activate these areas and establish strong east-west pedestrian connections. And give special focus to the design of the Vancouver and Main Street ends, and consider integrating a public component such as a plaza or other community space into these ends. So that concludes the overview of the PAC West options. I'd like to move into a discussion that focuses on the case study. And again, we want your initial feedback on the massing and design options prior to moving this rezoning forwards.
Thank you. Just a point with the through block walkway. I would be worried about sending a through block walkway through that block onto Loggers Lane. Just, Loggers Lane is our new truck route and our new busy downtown route to SOTC. And that makes absolutely no sense to me to have a three-block walkway into that without a crosswalk. I mean, I like the idea of being able to see through the dome. That's just.
Well, that comment makes sense. I think we would ensure that we did have one crosswalk.
Well, there's a cross, a lit crosswalk.
One mid block.
Yeah.
There's a lit crosswalk at Main Street. There's a lit crosswalk at Main Street. And you imagine being a truck driver coming from the terminals heading for the highway, and you're gonna just come around the corner and hit a light, and then you're gonna go another 100 feet and hit a light, and then 300 feet and hit, you know, I mean, I think you would not want another lit crosswalk. That's all. I mean, I don't understand the concept of adding another crosswalk on the freeway. An overhead walkway, maybe.
Yeah, and I think the future of Loggers Lane is a bit, I mean, it's truck route for now, but maybe the long-term vision is not necessarily for truck route, and with the waterfront becoming more activated and having a waterfront, a continuous waterfront walkway, I think we want to have a lot of connections through, but yeah.
We essentially determined that Loggers Lane was the truck route in the for long-term in our truck route study, correct?
Yes, that's right. However, there would be a sidewalk along Loggers Lane on this upper side, so it's not to direct people, you know, it's not going to capture the masses going through that site, but it's to provide convenience to connect over to the sidewalk that will be on Loggers Lane.
And that was one of the key comments from ADP, is that all four sides be pedestrian friendly, because it has four roads on it.
Absolutely.
Susan, Karen. Thanks. I prefer the split up massing of number four, and also the fact that it includes second floor office space all the way along. It's nice to see that there is consideration of that. It would be option three or four, but the massing and being able to have a view corridor through all three buildings, and the possibility to have differentiation between all three buildings also makes sense to me, and a little bit more interesting architecturally. And providing employment space on Cleveland Avenue and taking a lot that is for basically employment, I'd be supportive of option four. And I also agree with staff's comments about activation around all the sides, the second ground floor retail and the sidewalks. And I like the ADP's comments, I think they're thoughtful.
I know the proponents and representatives of proponents are in the audience, so I really want you to help join in the conversation if you want. So just join us at the table. Just following up on that, and then I have Karen and Doug. The ADP talked about, asked whether they could do all the parking on the second floor, so all the ground level is, or ground levels and taking up the parking, or have most of it on the second floor. And I just want to make sure, I'd like to understand, I wasn't in there with ADP, but what the rationale was.
I think the rationale was from ADP was to activate the streets, especially along Loggers, and to wrap the commercial or to wrap some sort of program around Loggers Lane and have, you know, an active sidewalk. So I think really the suggestion was less about moving it all up to the second floor, which I think would be counterproductive for commercial space, but to move it kind of more into the block. And we actually have some space to do that. When we laid out the site, we kept quite a bit of space on the Loggers side because Loggers is a narrow, has a narrower right of way at the moment. So we've left some space there that we could certainly accommodate some commercial and keep parking on two levels.
The other comment too was to have frontage that not necessarily commercial because there is no parking. It's a truck route. That's what we were told is a truck route, which we understand. But that potentially some of the office space that's on the top floor could actually be brought down to the lower floor. It doesn't necessarily need frontage if it's already on the second floor. If you bring some of that down, and that's something we can also look at. So
discussion about bringing some office space on that first floor was also really about reducing the amount of foot traffic and really concentrating foot traffic on the retail spaces on Cleveland and less so on Loggers where we have the truck route. And you know, it's more appropriate for offices where there's less kind of coming and going, you know, kind of throughout the day.
Thanks. So as far as the massing goes, I prefer option four or some variation of option four for similar reasons as Councillor Chappelle. And for me, it's very similar to the way I felt about the Solterra development that's now being built on a blind channel. Being able to kind of look through the development and get a sense of
Sorocco?
Or Sorocco, big word.
I see my point.
Right.
Yeah.
Start with S.
Does that go something?
The Sharaka development. So you're able to look through it because it's three separate buildings and get a sense of what's on the other side. In that case, it's the blind channel. And in this case, it's again the blind channel and parts of the chief. So I'm very much in favor of that. And I can remember the discussion I had in my first 3 months of council, actually, when we considered the development for that blind channel. It was just basically a four-story wall. And I made the same comments there. I want to get a sense of what's on the other side. I'm prepared to consider height in return for more open spaces between them and that trade-off. And I look at option four, and you're talking about signature buildings, and I agree with the ADP comments on that. I mean, this is a whole block. It's a real opportunity to do something and make a statement. And so in my mind, it opens up the possibility of some kind of activation of the spaces on top of the second floor between the buildings, which would be a little bit different from any other development we have right now. So very much in favor of that, or some variation on that. As far as Loggers Lane goes, I would like to see, I was one of the people that opposed the truck route, but don't go on to go back and debate that part of it. What I would like to see is activation of the Loggers Lane side of those Cleveland Avenue blocks. And it's not just this block, but it's all the way up Loggers Lane, because with the development that's going on Loggers Lane, Sharaco, and what might happen in Block 44, and then of course the park, which is not really an issue, but there's going to be a lot of things on Loggers Lane that will be attractive, potentially attractive, as well as the access to the walkway and so forth. So for me, activation of the Loggers Lane side of the development is quite important. And I recognize it's not retail, and it might be different than the Cleveland Avenue side, but not just to have a wall with a parking garage behind it, something more than that. Something that's, you know, maybe enticing for some people to walk down that sidewalk, and maybe there is the odd coffee shop in there, maybe a nice spot for it, or something like that, just to provide some activity there. The other thing to consider with that, and the trucks are a bit of a negative for me, but just so you don't have trucks going by at 100 miles an hour, I mean, just because it's a truck route doesn't mean it has to be a freeway. And you could reduce the speed along Loggers Lane to make it more pedestrian friendly, more friendly for people sitting in sidewalk patios or something like that, to make it people attractive and still accommodate trucks. So I think that's kind of our decision as opposed to the developer's decision, but I think that's the kind of thing we can think about doing for this and other developments that go on up the street.
Peter,
So for me, it's option three, a couple of reasons. First off, I like the fact that it doesn't impinge and intrude too far into the Ocean Pavilion side, and it has a plaza piece at the end of it, which sort of lends that whole openness to that corner. The other thing I find with four is I like to walk through the cutaways in the building, but I find the height is a little bit much for
really, I like all of them, but I'm kind of leaning to three for what Pete said. I mean, I like to keep that park area open. And, you know, to go back to Loggers Lane, you know, potentially from that, if we went with number three, and then there's no pedestrian walkway over Loggers Lane to the park, it would be a fabulous thing to have. I'm still not sold on even a sidewalk going up that side. And if you look at our park, I can remember 3 or 4 years ago, we had to put up a fence all the way down that side because all the little kids there were running out into traffic. And so, remember when we put that little fence through Pavilion Park there? And I watch, and while I'm in the park, I watch everybody mingling and doing their park stuff. And boy, you don't want anybody near that road. So, but I like the idea of the second floor on Loggers Lane side being animated, or that maybe where you want some commercial. I mean, what a great spot for an office. An office doesn't mind if the trucks are going by and would have a fabulous view of the water. But, I'm kind of happy with all of them, but I do like that area across from the park would be commercial and, you know, a couple stories, so there could be some commercial up there. That would be the spot to have your coffee shop.
Karen. Just curious, on the shade studies, is this a spring equinox or a fall equinox? Or
it's,
summer solstice?
It's the same. It's the same. Spring,
it's
spring and fall.
Yeah. Okay. And did we look at summer?
And that's the echo part of it all.
Can you look at the summer?
We have looked at all of them. We don't have them in this package. But in summer generally, the shadows are shorter. So, and of course in the winter we're covered by the chief for a lot more of the time. The chief's shadow.
Yeah. I prefer option 4. I am concerned about the shading on the park and also just the massing as you sit in the park and listen. What that looks like in front of you. So I think whatever is on the end of that building closest to the park needs to be really thoughtfully considered. It'd be great even to animate a second level in terms of restaurant or patio or just something that's not a wall. I like 4 because I think in hearing that the buildings can be different, it gives the developer a lot of creativity. Make them similar but I love the idea of walkthroughs, and I think that we're not building enough for our climate, so yep, it's really nice for 2 months of the year, but even some covered arcades between these buildings I think would be ideal. So in Melbourne you can dine year round, and I know some places in Gastown are trying to extend over so that people can, even with blankets or heaters, you could still be outside. So I think the walkthroughs provides an opportunity to think about an outdoor experience all year round. I don't mind having people walk through to Loggers Lane. I agree with Doug. I think that is going to be our access to a beautiful, eventually, waterfront walkway on the other side of what gets developed there and to our parks. So I think that makes a lot of sense. And I'm just curious about, I know your drawings are just to sort of give massing and form, but option 4 sort of shows this long podium that's sort of all connected, and ADP said to protect that sort of small shop articulation all the way down. So I'm a little bit curious about how we would achieve that if we went with option 4. Would it really be a one long podium?
Yeah, I think in all of the options, I mean, we're showing one long podium, but you know, we would certainly break that down, and you know, like you could have storefront bays that are different and articulated so that it would read much more like a street front, like the scale of Cleveland is right now as the buildings change, as you move, rather than make one building that looks, you know, entirely the same.
We agree with ADP's comments.
Yeah.
Yeah. So yeah, I lean towards option 4.
I'm gonna mess it all up. I actually like option 2. And I think it's not symmetrical viewpoint, in my mind. The shading, I think is pretty good. It gives some sunny spots in key locations. We can get distracted by the massing, and I think, you know, the architectural design will, once we get to that stage, will be a little clearer. But I kind of like how it, and I agree, some sort of a canopy or something over it, but I like the fact that you can walk through when it's outside and it's not underneath sort of a thing, but you could put some sort of cover over it, glass, so you can still see the sky and everything. But I'm kind of leaning towards option two. I like certainly the road ends, the sight lines are really good on both ends of the streets, both at Main and at Vancouver. I don't mind the height. I like the fact that one building is actually shorter than the other building. Gives some degree of variation there. Get away from what I like to call the Link sausage look. And I'm totally open to, and I'd like to hear what you guys prefer too from an architectural standpoint. I'm actually kind of liking option two from a first glance. Doug, Susan, Peter, Ted.
Thank you. Not commenting on that, but the reason I have my hand up is, you know, this is, maybe he's right, this is an opportunity for a real signature piece. And it's sort of a challenge, I think, for the developer to hit that standard. I think it's also a challenge for us. And we can kind of look at that area around there as well, because part of it is district land. And so what I'm thinking about is we should consider, for example, closing Main Street between the development and the park, and opening that up to pedestrian traffic and let the developer design not their building into that, but design the building accordingly. So I think we kind of want to take the blinders off a little bit and think about things like that. We talked about it in an earlier discussion a few weeks ago, possibly closing off very selected, these little cross streets that might not really be needed, just to put some more pedestrian places in the downtown area. And this might be one that staff could consider. So I'll just leave you with that comment.
Susan, you did, I really like that idea as well, and I do think thinking more globally about that area. And I think about Loggers Lane, and despite wanting every street to be active and pedestrian and lovely, we are going to have to think about the amount of density and traffic that is going to be in this area and leading to the oceanfront. And we do need one connected road to get in and out of Squamish, and Loggers Lane will be that road. It's designated by the public. We've been given public license to put our traffic onto Loggers Lane. And coming out of the oceanfront and the amount of density we're putting on Loggers Lane and in this area with the Main, with this buildings, I love the density. I think it's appropriate to have that amount of density in the area, but we do need to think about the fact that Loggers will carry all the traffic, and that the active street, if we start thinking about pedestrian blocks like Doug just said, then we allow room for pedestrians in active areas and keep them on a main street that's highly active and dense, and then have access to the walkway and viewscape that will be provided by having the walkway along the oceanfront there. So that's, I would like, as a question to staff, how many commercial square footage is in each option? It's not laid out in these plans. So option one, option. Yeah, it's in the room. So I think that option four provides the most amount of commercial space, and that is really what I'm looking for this area. For our downtown and for Cleveland Avenue, we really need to have activation with both employment lands and residential, and by allowing the height and density of option four, and I also, Doug suggested, which I didn't actually think about, was the spaces in between the buildings is being able to have active space and gathering space on the third floor in between those spaces, and being able to have grass, lawns, and parks off the street as well for the residences there, and maybe walkways through the buildings so that you can access public space in between the buildings. I think is a really fantastic option there. That's, yeah, and just, I think we do really want to go for maximum amount of square footage for employment lands, and breaking it up in between the buildings really provides us the best option for public space. I'm not worried about shading for Pavilion Park. I would like to see that, maybe even as a public amenity, that the Ossian Pavilion be changed into something that can be used for actual theater and music. Yeah, but that, like, instead of thinking about shading, I want to think about how we're going to activate that area.
Let's focus on this development.
I am focusing on this development. If we're going to change that to public space and we're talking about walkways and shutting off the areas around, I would also like to think about how this space interacts with our public park.
Peter?
And to that point, I do concern myself a bit with the shading on Ossian. I like, that's the reason I'm kind of adhering to Austin Tree, and I love Doug's idea of closing off that street and just making it into an open walking area for people to be able to go back and forth to the shops, especially if you have something going on in the park with a concert or whatever, you can walk through there, you have no fears of traffic. I think it's a great idea to the developer. I think that's something you should really have a look at, because there's something marvelous you can do with that space. To keep it open and have restaurants on the ground floor, and have that with option three, where the building is not quite so abutted up against the park, so you still have sunlight falling on that plaza in there, and that open sense, and then with the street closed off, would make a really nice, nice area.
Ted?
Yeah, thanks. I've gone from option three to option two.
Traitor.
Yeah, well, I mean, I'm listening to Patty, and I was looking more at the plan than the cross section, and I like the two personality buildings rather than three sisters, a brother and a sister.
Pretty one ask which one.
Yeah, but and I really like Doug's idea about cutting off Main Street. I mean, you know, that could really do a lot of things. And I know if this is a signature building, I could just see that incorporated into it, and I still think we have to keep in mind a second floor pedestrian access across to the park, or across over Martyrs Lane, and as everything gets more and more busy, I think it's going to be something that's really needed, and it would be nice if this development brought that to us.
One of the things that I've heard before is that it's more challenging to put commercial and office and residential all in the same building. I don't know if that's true or not, but it's feedback that I've received. So one of the questions I have, if we do two or three buildings, is can we leave one of them as sort of a more traditional retail residential, and then use the other one as retail, maybe a couple floors of office, so that it's more dense in one building. So rather than trying to sprinkle it through all buildings, does it make it easier from a design and building code perspective to just
to coalesce more and more
the office space in sort of one place?
We have looked at that. It's definitely possible. But I think with the second floor, it gives us a really good opportunity to have a lot of second floor commercial space. So rather than mix up a lot of the uses, like to actually have like the entire available first floor as retail space or commercial space, and then on the second floor have, you know, equally a very large amount of office space. Then we start putting it into the individual buildings above that, then we really start to restrict the amount of area that's available. It becomes more challenging. But you're absolutely right, especially on smaller sites, doing that is more difficult, more costly, but we have the opportunity of a really big site here. So I think we have the opportunity to get a lot of commercial space in.
And I know that ADP said they didn't have a problem with 4 and 6 stories. Did you explore, well, some of these options, I think, 8, right?
Their general comments from the May ADP were that 4 and 6 were palatable. Specifically, when we brought them the PacWest site in August, there was comments that they thought 8, some even thought 6 was too high, and there was a few opinions that wanted to see more of continuous long building, but that's a bit counterintuitive to what you said. You want to avoid kind of a sausage of like a wall, a long wall, but there's people on ADP who prefer that typology, so it was for sure mixed feedback from them.
And you know, to that, we could explore a four-story recovery in the whole site, but you know, there's definitely trade-offs. You know, in option number two, we are going higher. You get higher, but then you get more space between the buildings, really, and that's really what the trade-off is. So if you want to see more views through the buildings, then you make the footprint of the building smaller and put a few more of them out there. I think that's, you know, that's what we've done in option four, so that we've got more space between the buildings. I think there's an opportunity to vary that, you know, so it's kind of a combination of option two and option four, where you wouldn't have, you know, three identical buildings, but actually start varying the heights and the floor plates of those and make them higher, you know. And I think that, you know, just looking at some of the renderings, I don't think you're blocking out much more of the view by going higher. In fact, I think you're opening it to the sides of the view.
So just, I think often, I get that vernacular in an urban environment, more that consistent four-story or whatever. When we have these spectacular views, that's why I sort of think we need to open it up and have some variance. So when I looked at the, I didn't look too closely at the GFA of residential commercial office. I thought there was some flexibility in there. If we want to achieve a little bit more office, we can tweak design things to get there. So I wasn't overly concerned about judging this just on how much office or commercial. So maybe my question is there flexibility within these four options? I mean, I'm assuming there's options 2A, 3A, 4A, B, C, to ensure that we're achieving some of the goals in terms of viewscapes and shadowing and all that sort of stuff, but still having some flexibility that can get a bit more office here or there, depending on if it's development building. Like,
yeah.
I'm assuming those numbers are movement a little bit.
Absolutely. You know, the what we tried to do was with the four options was really kind of balance it as much as possible so that the options have the same, you know, a very similar amount of residential space, a similar amount of office space, commercial space. So, you know, in terms of that, there literally are, you know, kind of infinite possibilities of what that mix might be. And what we're really, really interested in getting in terms of feedback is you know, feedback on, you know, how the massing would work. Do we have, you know, a number of, you know, break it up into a number of buildings at different heights? Do we want to pull it away from the park side? Do we want to pull it away from the brew pub side? Because there really is a lot of kind of mix and match opportunity between the four options. So if you like option three because it's pulled away from the park and it doesn't shade the park, you know, that feature of it could be, you know, introduced into any of the other options. We kind of envision that there'll be a, you know, get a kind of sense of what the preferences are on all of the options and try to combine them into a single option that responds to as many of those as possible.
One thing I would like to know, because there's probably not consensus in our office or between us and planning, what's more important, the brew pub views or the park side? Because you can see that building, it moves. So if it's right in the middle, then everyone's okay. If it's pushed to one side, one's great. So you can look at option three and say, well, I love that it's open to the park. Or you can turn around and say, well, I love that it's open to the brew pub. Because one side is close to the property line. Not that we need to build it like that, because we're trying to hear what everyone's saying, but that's a big one that I'm trying to figure out. What's more important to council? The view from the brew pub or the experience from the park? Because that will tell Andreas, for example, if it is option two, which side should the taller building be on? Should it be over the park, or should it actually be anchoring the other end to be the anchor of Cleveland? So it's, you know, you're really got two opposing bookends. So I would like to hear what people think, or if they're equal, one's more, one's less, or generally. So it helps Andreas kind of place things.
I think that's one of the reasons I like option two, is it gives some of that on both ends, and significantly in the middle, which is awesome. do have Susan here, Karen, and we have to wrap the meeting up.
Thank you. For me, Cleveland Avenue, we're residentializing everywhere, and we still have to maintain employment space, and we have to be very cognizant of this is employment lands. We are using up employment lands, and we have to replace some employment. We can't continue building high-density residential without building some workspace. To half the amount of workspace on the second floor where professionals need to work makes no sense to me in option two. So that's why option four makes a lot of sense, just because of the different massing. And cut-ins and everything else. I think you can do cut-ins for the brew pub, even for the cut-ins for the views for both ends, and ensure that there's good views. But I'm not on Cleveland Avenue. There's going to have to be some compromise between views from every corner of every lot and every pub to saying we need some workspace, or people are not going to enjoy the views because they have to leave town and go to work. So if you have to leave town and go to work, you're not really concerned about views. If you want a view, you can walk a block that way and walk all the way up and down the oceanfront and have spectacular seaside views. But to take Cleveland Avenue up for just residential and not consider second floor employment space for your residences is going to be a big mess. So we have to. This is already adding a huge amount of density with not enough workspace on an employment lot that is currently zoned only for employment and not for residential. So ensuring the 20,000 square feet of office space, it's C4 now, isn't it?
No, it is.
It's currently all residential.
It's CD zone.
Okay, but for Cleveland Avenue, I just think that ensuring employment, as we use up, we've zoned lots of other lots into pure residential.
We're good with everything.
Yeah,
from our point of view, we know we want a mixed-use building,
yeah.
And the site is big enough to do, I think, what everyone wants. I think we're kind of clear on the direction so far.
And I think we all agree. We want to maximize our employment space, whether it's office, commercial. We have it. That's our goal,
yeah,
our long-term
absolutely.
Goal. Because if we don't build it now, we'll never get it. So, they said all of these options can be manipulated. Those are not hard numbers on square footage on commercial or on office for the third time. Sorry. Pete, Karen, Doug, and then we need to wrap up.
Mike's point about asking where he thought that the more open space should exist, and for me it's towards the downtown, towards Osium Park, and keeping that, we'll call it Doug's Plaza, open, and that piece. But just anyway, keeping that towards the downtown side, keeping that openness, I think, because we need those spaces in the downtown area. And for me, another concern of mine is the height, 8 stories. I just don't want to impinge on the view from the neighbors directly across the street or for the other residents further to the west. And I think also, I don't think we're ever going to see anything coming in at the oceanfront, which the property's directly across from it, by the way, probably 6 to 8 stories. So I think that those heights in there will probably, we haven't seen anything yet coming through there, but I think when it does start off, I don't think we're going to look at anything that's that massive.
consensus. I mean, I can, similar to Karen, I can live with two because it does accomplish some of the things that I look for in four, which is being able to get a sense of the other side of the development. And to Mike's question about where do you, which view do you compromise, I think if you took two and flipped it around, assuming that south is on the right and north is on the left, and you had the taller building down there, I would be inclined, frankly, to favor keeping open the view from the brew pub just because it's an existing business. And the people on the balcony sitting there don't have anywhere else to go. But in the park, you can just move down a little bit to the other end of the park. There's huge spaces in those parks. There's a park on the water that's not encumbered at all with views. And there's the next block that they will see in Pavilion, which is a whole practically a block long. And then there's also a bit across the street. So people can't see this cheap. They can kind of just move over a bit, but you don't have that option from the roof up. So I'd be inclined to put the height down there. The other thing with putting the lower building up closer to the park is I think it would reduce the shading in the park a little bit. I'm not really fussed about that, but it is a concern to some people, and so I recognize that. I think if you drop down a couple of floors there, it might ease that issue a little bit.
Okay,
Ted, your last word.
Okay, well, I don't mind eight stories, and I like the idea of two being connected.
Okay, so council's been pretty consistent on this. We want to see office life, we want to see commercial, we want to see a good quality and quantity of those uses in any of these buildings that are going downtown. You've got six different opinions. So have fun with that. But I think generally there's actually more consensus. We want to see those viewscapes on the road ends. We want to be sensitive to some of the shading issues and the integration with the park into this. If you know, I think council is open to something that shows us something pretty cool that we can actually maybe close down that short block on Main Street. We look forward to the next coming back for application. Is that helpful?
Yeah, very helpful, actually.
Okay, for
I need to say this, but rather for the rest.
There's a part B to the discussion too.
Is there?
There is.
Mayor Heisman, we were just talking amongst ourselves this afternoon at committee of the whole. Staff are bringing back the public engagement process for these regulations. And staff are talking about dovetailing in the second part, which is the broader discussion. If you're okay with that on the agenda.
You guys okay with that on the agenda? Can you stick around for a little bit?
I have a public hearing in Waybrook at 5 o'clock. Yes.
We can put it right at 1.
Okay. But does it only tag them?
Is it not?
Well, it's the discussion about approaches to regulate height on Cleveland in general.
Okay,
it's broadening the discussion.
Yeah, because we do need to break and we do need to come back. So we will put it after 1. Give staff some time to eat. Sorry. But we can move that right at the beginning of the meeting.
So just so I understand, what is that meeting or discussion on?
So we're talking, it's related, but it's broadening the discussion to talk about how we're going to move forward on regulating height along Cleveland.
So just a motion to accept the minutes, to approve the minutes from July 4th, moved by Peter, seconded by Ted. All those in favor?